with the world. Do not be yoked with the world. I was praying this week concerning this morning and just felt like the Lord sovereignly laid this message on my heart. There are many things happening in the world right now. Anybody hear about the transgender bathroom situation?
No.
You know, unfortunately, what people have been joking about is becoming a reality. There really are grown men that are going to begin to walk into women's restrooms. It's the reality that we're living in. And, you know, it's always when we start these conversations and sermons, a lot of people just tend to shut down. And I just want to encourage you, wake up. Wake up. We have got to wake up. And I think that we've done our best to be a lighthouse, to become a lighthouse of truth and of love in this region and in the nation. And I really believe now is the time to take our stand. I really believe what the world simply needs is Christians acting like Christ.
Amen.
I almost wish it was harder than that, but it's not. What we actually need is people every day that they live in their workplace representing and modeling the biblical values that are in Scripture, the life of Jesus. We need you and I walking separated, holy, devoted, consecrated unto the Lord. And so I really felt like the Lord wanted me and reminded me of the Scripture in Ephesians 5, where it talks about how God cleanses us with the washing of the Word. And what I believe the Lord wants to happen this morning is for us to be washed with the Word. So what does that mean? We're going to read a lot of Scriptures. Is Bible reading okay?
Yes.
Bible reading okay? I listened to a couple sermons 3 weeks ago that were sent to me. Not one Bible verse was mentioned in a sermon. We've got to get into the Word of God. So pray with me. The title of this message is called, Do Not Be Yoked with the World. Father, I'm just asking in the name of Jesus for a spirit of living revelation to rest upon this community. Lord, I just pray, Lord, that your spirit would rest upon us in power. Lord, I pray for conviction. I pray for grace. Holy Spirit, awaken us to all that you did for us. Lord, we thank you for the work of Jesus on the cross. Lord, I just pray that you'd confirm and wake us up this morning. Lord, I pray for the state of North Carolina. God, I pray that your fire would fall. Lord, I just pray, Lord, even where they have legislated, Lord, this law, God, I ask that you would turn it. Lord, we're even believing that Roe versus Wade would be turned in America. Lord, I just thank you that this is the hour to rise up. Rise up, Lord. We just thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. I'm going to read a scripture, Romans chapter 6. But if you have your Bible, go ahead and turn to 1 Corinthians 6. I'm going to begin reading in Romans 6, but if you have your Bible, turn to 1 Corinthians 6. Romans 6:6, it says, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him, that our body of sin might be done away with. Can you say done away with?
Done away.
It's gone. That we should no longer be slaves to sin. Verse 11. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your body, that you should obey its lusts. I have taken a lot of Wednesday nights at Heart of the Father and taught on salvation. I believe I've taught biblical grace. I preached a similar message on Easter Sunday. I have a passion to help Christians understand what actually happened when we said yes to Jesus. And I'm going to briefly mention it. If I could sum up what happened when we said yes to Jesus, hopefully it was more than a prayer. I do not believe that people are saved because they say a prayer. I believe people are saved because they walk and talk and act like Jesus Christ. They have entered into some form of discipleship where they're being fathered and mentored in the ways of the Lord. And so one of the first things that happens is the power of the sin nature is broken off of our lives. I'm going to talk for a second about BC days, before Christ. Before you and I knew Christ, we habitually and continually lived a lifestyle of sin. You and I were good sinners. People that don't know the Lord, what do? Best? They sin because the power of the sin nature has not been broken off of their life. What they crave, I want you to picture people that don't know the Lord. They've never truly had a born-again experience. They are continually given over to the lust of the flesh and feeding that desire. That was you and I at one time. But thank God for the cross. Thank God for the life of Jesus, where when He died, we died with Him. Our old man, that sin nature, was crucified with Jesus. I'm preaching you the truth now. Don't dial out on me. The devil loves to keep Christians mediocre because they give themselves to mediocre truth. The power of the sin nature has been broken off of your life. You know it's you don't need it. In Jesus Christ, it's no longer I can't, but I won't. In Jesus Christ, it's no longer I can't, but I won't. There's no such thing as I can't overcome pornography. That is a lie from the devil. No, you won't get over pornography. You and I have to put our faith in the power of the blood of Jesus that speaks a better word. He is teaching us literally to look at sin with disgust. I'm talking about someone BC days that loved to look at a pornography and the images that it provided them. In Jesus Christ, it makes them physically sick to even think about pornography. And I could name a whole other list of sins, but the power of the sin nature has been broken off of our lives. First thing. The second thing, He replaced it with the divine nature. The very life of God is on the inside of you if you've been born again. I literally believe the Lord is speaking truths to the church right now, like, you are the dwelling place of God. Some of us need to get struck with awe and wonder that Jesus Christ has taken up residence within you. He calls you His address. He calls you His. You are mine, says the Lord. We've been bought with a price. Everything that we, I'm just preaching the word of God. Everything that we need, 1 Peter 2, for life and godliness has been given to us in Jesus Christ. So the power of the sin nature has been broken off of our lives. This is the best combo pack you've ever heard of. The power of the sin nature has been broken off of our lives. He's infused us with His very life. What we once craved, we don't crave any longer. I was once bound and addicted to pornography, but because of the blood of Jesus, the stronghold off of my life was broken, lies were exposed, and I live a life of purity and freedom. I've made a covenant with my eyes. You fill in whatever you're going through. And here's how good God is. He not only breaks the power of the sin nature, He not only gives us His nature, but here's the addition too. He gave you the Holy Ghost. Hey. Oh, come on. Somebody say hallelujah. God, You did all this for me. See, this is me when someone says, oh, the Lord saved me. I'm like, bro, do you really know what you're talking about? How can we just drink coffee and just only save me? I'm like, do you understand what you're talking about? Saved by grace, amazing grace. How sweet the sound. I'm like, is anybody else ready to run and shout? He gave us the Holy Spirit who lives on the inside of us. He's the revealer of truth. He's the comforter. He's the healer. He's the paraclete. He's the advocate. He has walked and talked with you since the day you gave your life to Christ.
Yes.
I mean, I want you to get this. There's a real person on the inside of you. And for some of you, all it's going to take to catch fire is to believe what I'm saying. There's a real person on the inside of you who will lead you and guide you into all truth and righteousness. And by the way, he's full of joy. He is joy. No more miserable Christianity. Why are all the Christians miserable? We sit in church and act like we're missing out on what's going out in there. What I'm telling you, I'm prophesying to you. Days are coming to the church when the world is going to wonder what's going on in here. Because praise has become our weapon. I don't care what's legislated in America. God is good. And Jesus Christ is coming back for a pure and a spotless bride. He's after a remnant in America. Jesus, the real God man, the beautiful one. He's coming back for you and I. He hasn't left us without an answer. He doesn't want you hopeless and depressed. He doesn't want you sick and mad up. Is anybody awake this morning? Stuff is at our door. Jesus Christ did not die for mediocre Christianity. The reason why Lakeland's not saved is because we're not acting saved.
Bring it.
I'm not angry. I don't even eat before I preach, so I have the energy. And I'm just reading the news and I'm watching this stuff and I'm like, I don't understand the fear response. I really don't. I don't understand the, let's just go crawl in the prayer room. And I love to pray, but I'm ready to see the gospel of Jesus Christ demonstrated. People need to see us acting and walking and talking like him. They will know that we're his disciples by the way that we love one another. Telling you, how is God going to break in at my workplace? Not by you really getting touched here. It's by God touching you there. Preach on this Wednesday night. I want to encourage you, some of you guys, you need to make Wednesday nights a priority. As we gather during the midweek, I preach a sermon on Wednesday about drawing near. This is the season where we've got to enter in to the holy place and put our confidence in the blood of Jesus. So are you with me this morning? That was the intro. Okay, so this is what God has done for you. Are we good? Okay, everyone in this room, I want you to hear me, okay? And have dreams about me, okay? Okay, the power of the sin nature has been broken off of your life. We have died to sin. Paul says, how could we live in it any longer? It has no power over us if we name the name of Jesus. Secondly, the divine nature, his very nature, lives on the inside of you. If we continually and habitually lived in sin, BC, why are we not habitually and continually living in righteousness once we found him? Why are we okay with people radically serving the devil, but we can't stand when people radically serve Christ? How do we go to football games and basketball games? People getting full body paint, crazy hair. They do push-ups on the crowd. We give them a license to act crazy and cheer with them. But yet when somebody catches us a hold of how God sees them, how he takes delight in them, that he saved them, delivered them, set them free, when they come down to an altar and start shouting and screaming, we act like something's wrong with them. No, brother, something's wrong with you. Forgotten the work of Calvary. I'm telling you, when we lose sight of the cross, we need revival. We're We're looking for new revelation. We're looking for new prophetic truth. There's nothing new under the sun. Paul only knew Jesus Christ and Him crucified. It was the preaching of the resurrection that turned cities and nations upside down in the book of Acts. I'm telling you, the greatest apostolic preaching is yet to be preached in the American church. We are going to hear messages on His life, His death, His burial, His resurrection, His ascension, His second coming. Jesus is coming to light you and I up. Not another sermon series on the latest movie. I don't care about what Hollywood is producing. I want to hear what heaven is producing. Jesus Christ doesn't need to be produced. He just needs to be introduced. I'm telling you, a train's taking off. Some of you are like, I want my building fund money back. Oh, I can't wait till we get on a main road where people can actually find us. I'm telling you, if you think we're getting a bigger building so we can water it down and go program style, leave now. We're going to have a bigger sanctuary, a bigger kids church, a bigger youth group to set people on fire with the gospel. Lakeland, we're coming for you. And we are going to be unashamed about what Jesus did for us. Keep telling people, are you Holy Spirit filled or not? What is the baptism of the Holy Ghost for? Witnessing. I don't care if you can pray in tongues. Hear me. I don't care if you can pray in tongues at the altar. Are you evangelizing your workplace? Love you guys. I'm really not angry, but I'm telling you, the zeal of the Lord is being released right now. And you and I have got to make a choice. The Lord is drawing a line. We will know Him as the God who answers by fire. Where were we? Galatians 1:4, the Lord Jesus Christ gave Himself up for our sins that He might deliver us from this present evil age. The Lord Jesus gave Himself up for our sins, not so that we could hang out in our sins, but so that we could get delivered from the present evil age that we're living in. 1 Corinthians 6, let's begin getting washed and taking a good old bath this morning. In the Word of God, we might have some squealing pigs, but we are just going to get washed in the Word this morning. 1 Corinthians 6:16. Or do you not know that the one who joins himself to a harlot is one body with her? For he says the two will become one flesh. But the one who joins himself to the Lord is one spirit with Him. Flee immorality. Can you say flee?
Flee.
Can you say flee?
Flee.
Good. Every other sin that a man commits is outside the body, but the immoral man sins against his own body. Or do you not know, here's the revelation, that your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, who is in you, whom you have from God, catch this, and you are not your own. Beloved, I hate to break it to you, but this isn't invite Jesus into the buffet line with everything else that you're doing. This is you invite Jesus in and all the darkness scatters. This is not ordering Jesus around our schedule. This is ordering our schedule around Jesus.
Yeah. Thank you, Lord.
Okay, just put your hand on your belly. Let's do a Benny Hinn thing. Good morning, Holy Spirit. He's living in you. I mean, I love it's just not the Spirit, it's the Holy Spirit. Why we think we continually and habitually live in sin and go to heaven, where, by the way, they cry out, holy, holy, holy. A A holy God is living on the inside of us, and when we choose to fornicate, guess who we drag in there with us? This is the very rhetoric that Paul used when he confronted immorality in the Corinthian church. How can you join yourself in sexual immorality and therefore despise the Spirit of God who you drug in there with you? And I always ask people the question, if Jesus was there, would you do it? I mean, if alcohol isn't one of the greatest ways to get people all fired up, I just say, well, if Jesus was there, would you have a few beers with him? If not, I'll let your own conscience guide you. If Jesus was there, would you look at that computer screen? If Jesus was there, would you lie to your boss? If Jesus is there, would you steal and would you launder? Would you? If Jesus was there, well, guess what? He's not only there, he lives inside of us. He sees what you see. He hears what you hear. He knows your thoughts and your heart attitudes before you even speak them.
Yes.
You have been bought with a price. See, we hate this word slaves. See, BC days before him, we were slaves to sin. Beloved, we don't go from slaves to sin to, I accept Christ, I'm under grace, I'll do whatever I want, thank you. No, we go from being slaves and bound to sin to giving our life to Jesus, being bought with a price, and we're now slaves to what he wants us to do. Three of you. This is the gospel! It's like a pearl that a man found in a field that had such great worth. It was like, oh my gosh, this thing is beautiful. And it had such infinite worth to him that he went back and sold everything that he had for that pearl. I'm talking about people literally encountering Jesus Christ and the power of the cross. And it so radically shakes them that they give up everything for Jesus. And here's the thing. They gladly do it.
Yeah.
Tell you, some of us, this mindset that you have right now is, oh my gosh, this sounds miserable. No, the joy of the Lord is our strength. There's a place in Jesus where you will gladly do it because you're in love. Maybe that's the issue. We said a prayer, but we never fell in love. This is the message I've been preaching across America, everywhere that we go. It's not about church attendance. It's about a radical encounter with Jesus.
Yes.
He's coming back for oil and lamps. Not, well, I went to church on Sunday and then went and did whatever that I wanted. We have got to cultivate the oil of intimacy in our lives, and it's time to get excited about it.
Yes.
Anybody excited today? The joy of the Lord. It's like it's an honor and a privilege to serve Jesus. When people don't want to cuss around you at work, hallelujah. Don't you dare feel bad about that. Praise God. Or do you not know? Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who's in you. I just ready to run through that wall. Somebody video that. Whom you have, I'm not doing it. And that you are not on your own. Verse 20, here it is. Let this sink in your spirit, man. Verse 20. Read this with your spirit, man. For you have been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. Been bought with a price. I've been bought with a price. I've been bought with a price. I am not my own. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I that live, but he that lives in me.
Yeah.
Don't be surprised when God asks you to do crazy things. It's him.
Thank you.
I'm literally walking in a reality right now where if it's easy, I say it's not from God. I'm looking for God to tell me, give $10,000 away. Well, all I have is $10,000 away. That's my flesh. No, the Lord said, give $10,000 away. Here you go, Will. The Lord doesn't do negotiations.
Amen.
Negotiations are over because of the cross. I just feel like we just, oh, like, Lord, can you just get up on the cross one more time? So I told this kid the other day, he said, what do I do? I said, dude, go watch The Passion. If that thing doesn't make you cry, you're religious. I literally believe a sign of religion overtaking you is when you can't cry anymore. Oh, by the way, real men cry. Literally, I'm looking for fathers that will model for their children what it means to weep as they encounter Jesus.
Right.
Not some hard-hearted, hypocritical, acting like everything's okay at church when he's not representing Jesus inside the home.
Right. I totally agree.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mother. All right, you with me? I had a young man the other day I have here looking for advice. A guy called me up. I don't know how he got my number. He said, Jeremiah, I just got saved. I need some advice about where to go to church and how to grow in Christ. And what came up out of my spirit, I've said this before, the Lord spoke through me. And this is what the Lord said. Young man, stay away from churches who make you feel at home in this world. Going somewhere. Young man, stay away from church. Do you know that the church was never created to be a subculture for the world? The church was never created to be a subculture for the world. By definition, the word ecclesia, it means called out ones. When people walk into the doors of a church, they should encounter people that have been rewired by God Himself.
Amen.
What I once craved before Him, if I walk in the doors of a church and they're still craving worldly things, I'm going to think they either haven't given their life to Jesus or they're deceived about it. Young men, stay away from people. Stay away from churches and ministries who make you feel at home in this world. Because here's the thing. I'm gonna start winding the plane. If the power of the sin nature has been broken off of your life, if the very life of God has been imparted into you, if the Holy Spirit dwells inside of you, here's the revelation. You don't fit in anymore.
That's right.
You don't fit in anymore. When you said yes to Jesus, it required you to say no to something else. Okay, you don't believe me? 1 Peter 2:11. Track with me. Let's get bathed again. Here comes the soap. Hurry, let's get there. Many of us, we've spent 50, 60 hours this week at work getting polluted by the things of the world. Here we go, 1 Peter 2:11. Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers, literally, you have permission to turn to your neighbor right now and say, what's up, alien? What's up, stranger? Another translation says, pilgrim, sojourner. Here's the reality. When you said yes to Jesus, the world stopped becoming your home. And you were seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
You and I were born for eternal glory.
Yeah.
We were created to sit at the right hand of the Lord, literally to enjoy His pleasures forevermore. Listen to Peter with urgency. Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly lusts. What do they do? They wage war against your soul. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles so that in the thing in which they... Get this. This is so good. I've been getting messed up by this. This is so good. And the thing in which they slander you as evildoers, that they might on account of your good deeds. In other words, if people are going to say something bad about us, what I want something bad said about me is, that guy actually lives like Jesus.
Amen.
Listen, I'm totally cool if people hate me and they hate Heart of the Father, because we not only name the name of Jesus, we walk and act and talk like Him. I get emails all the time from university students that go to universities in this county. One of them the other day sent me an email I get all the time. Jeremiah, I hate your church. I said, why? They said, because every time I come, I feel convicted of my sin. I type back in caps, welcome to the gospel. All men will hate you because of me, but he who stands firm to the end shall be saved. Woe to you when all men speak well of you. Beloved, persecution is coming. Hallelujah! Persecution is coming. Hallelujah. Yes. Do you know, historically, the only way the church experiences exponential growth is when crazy people start killing Christians? Yes. Who knows? Maybe Hillary Clinton is going to become the president of the United States, and the church is going to wake up like never before.
Yes.
None of them. Yeah. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. Mm. Lord, I have no idea what you want to do, but I say yes. Hey. I am unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. This is what the world needs. People obsessed and possessed and fascinated with the person of Jesus Christ, and they're excited about it. Yeah. We are living in a generation of face-to-face encounters. Can I speak to some of the older folks in here, the more mature saints among us? Listen, the way that you did church, it can't work any longer. I get emails from older people saying, Jeremiah, you're too hard on this generation. You need to simmer it down a little bit. Let me tell you, people are tired of being patronized.
Right.
They don't want to drive through church in an hour. They want an experience of Jesus Christ. Let the pot roast burn.
Hey.
Listen, your child can stay in kids' church 5 minutes longer, dear God. Okay, now I'm stepping on golden calves. I mean, they can stay out late when you're on a date, but they've got to go to bed early when God is moving.
Whoa.
Come on. Dude, when God is moving, who cares what I'm doing? If I really believe that there's... Oh, come on. There is one day in His court than a thousand else. And here's the thing, I really, Will's ready to take up another offer. Some churches, they'd be throwing money on the floor. But give it back to them, don't be deceived. And what we're calling radical today in the church is just biblical. What we're calling, listen, if you think I'm radical, go read the Bible. No, I'm serious. These men, I'm frustrated right now. You can probably tell. I'm just reading my Bible. Listen, this is what I'm like Monday morning tomorrow. I'm going to be in here reading the Gospels, and I'm just going to say, Lord, I don't even know you. I don't even know you, Lord. Show me. Teach me. Reveal to me. Let me just wake up to what the cross provided for me. The thing is, I'm just, revelation is flowing this morning. The scales are falling from our eyes. We're beginning to recognize little by little what He did 2,000 years ago. But as aliens and foreigners and strangers, we have got to stop wasting our time trying to fit in. You're a weirdo. Honestly, I just, like, as you leave today, I want to give you permission to settle into your identity as a Jesus freak. Let's invite jars of clay. I don't really care. talks, talk. You can tell. We good?
Just play with the phone.
We've got it growing. They're not going to fit in. It's okay. They're not going to like you. Praise God. Maybe they're looking for someone that actually not just believes in Jesus with their words and walks and talks with him with their lifestyle. Maybe that's what the world is looking for. I believe it. But we've got to understand who we are in him. We've got to get these revelations. Let me just close Daniel chapter 1. What time is it, Will? Daniel chapter 1. When I travel, I don't leave most places till 2 or 3. And there you go. Daniel chapter 1. How about our boy Daniel? Who lived in Babylon, but the spirit of Babylon was not in him. And I'm feeling just the stirring of the Holy Spirit. Can I just encourage some of you young people, maybe especially some of the young ladies in here who aren't married, to hold out for the man of God that he has for you?
Amen.
I better not even go there.
Go for it.
You have free reign here.
Daniel chapter 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God. And he brought the vessels into the treasury of his God. Then the king ordered, whatever that guy's name is, the chief of his officials, to bring in some of the sons of Israel, including some of the royal family and of the nobles. Look at verse 4. Youths, this is the kind of youth group I want. Youths in whom was no defect, who were good looking. All the young ladies say amen. Ladies, Taylor, you can give them amen. Good looking, that's good. Showing intelligence and every, see, these are kind of the men fathers want their daughters to marry. And every branch of wisdom, endowed with understanding and discerning knowledge, who had the ability for serving in the king's court. And he ordered them to teach them literature and language of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed for them a daily ration from the king's choice food and from the wine which he drank, and appointed that they should be educated 3 years, at the end of which they were to enter the king's personal service. Now among them from the sons of Judah were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Then the commander of the officials assigned new names to them. One of the very first things that the enemy does to us to deceive us is he tries to give us a new name. He tries to blind you to your identity in Jesus. I'm telling you, if the devil can blind you to the truth that you have heard this morning, he will have power and dominion over your life. He gave them a new name. Belteshazzar, to Hananiah, Shadrach, to Mishael, Meshach, and to Azariah, Abednego. Listen to verse 8. But Daniel made up his mind that he would not defile himself with the king's choice food, or with the wine which he drank. So he sought permission from the commander of the officials that he might not defile himself. Now God granted Daniel favor and compassion in the sight of the commander of the people. Hear me, some of us, God has not yet granted favor and compassion because we have not yet stepped out in faith to what he's calling us to. Daniel made up his mind. I'm calling on the heart of the Father family. It's time to make up our mind. Many of us have been here 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. It's time to make up our mind. Are we all in or not? Love Damon Thompson. He said, you know that you're a true son or daughter of the kingdom. You can't really know that until everything's for sale. Literally, the Lord wants to get us to the place where everything is on the table. We're just not going to give God things. We're going to get on the altar and give Him our life. Daniel in Babylon. I literally believe many people are defiling themselves by eating of the king's delicacies. We are dining at the table of the world. We are yoked to the world, and we are wondering where the hunger for God is. Appetite dictates the direction of our lives. Whatever you're hungry for, that's the direction that you're going to run in. Let's say no to the American dream. Let's say no to the part of the American dream where we acquire and we spend our lives literally building piles of dung. And we hoard our resources and we hold them back. Okay, I'm stepping on more toes. And we hold them back from the kingdom of God. You know what Daniel and these boys got a revelation of? I'm a son of Yahweh. Yahweh, He is God. The world around me might be acting one way. This is why A.W. Tozer, he said this, the once born will never understand the twice born. Do you know you're twice born? This is the revelation he gave Nicodemus. Again, what does it mean to be twice born? Power of the sin nature has broken them off of my life. Divine nature has been planted inside of me. The Holy Ghost and fire dwells within. It's okay if I can't get along with them. We're called to be in the world, not of it. Do people know that you're saved at your work? Or are you practicing closet Christianity? Come on, guys. Oh, is the Lord not good enough? He can't get you a new job if you get fired? Let me read it one more time. But Daniel made up his mind that he would not defile himself. Then what happened? Verse 9. God granted Daniel favor. Hey, maybe if some of us actually stand up and get fired, we stand up for Christ and get fired, maybe He'll promote you and give you a better job where you're making more money. Man, if the church is going down, we're going down swinging, but praise God. The gates of hell are not going to prevail against. I want to try to give us some victorious eschatology. I don't know how other else to name it. Jesus wins in the end. Let's just go full steam ahead. Bring it on. Who cares? Who's president? Who cares? I love Jesus. How about you? Look at this. Let's keep reading. And the commander of ten of the officials said to Daniel, I am afraid of my lord the king, who has appointed you food and your drink, for why he should see your faces looking more haggard than the youths who are your own age. Then you would make me basically get beheaded. Look at Daniel 11. This is a boy. But Daniel said to the overseer whom the commander of the officials had appointed over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, please test your servants for 10 days and let us be given some vegetables to eat and water to drink. Oh, hallelujah. Are you ready? Are you ready? In an hour of crisis, what is God's chosen instrument to make war on the culture? Fasting! Yep. Can that American dream where our God is our belly. We literally order our lives based on what restaurant we're going to and what's for dinner. God's answer in an hour of crisis is prayer and fasting. It's for youth, Radshak, Meshach, and Abednego, and Daniel. Listen, the youth in this story are setting the pace for the culture. What if God is raising up the youth of America, holy, consecrated, devoted unto the Lord, where even how they live will convict their parents. Do it, Lord. Do it, Lord. This is why the church is so important. Who cares if their parents won't come to church? Let's send a bus and pick the kids up.
Amen. Yes.
Yes. Hey. Do you know we have a bus at Heart of the Father? We have a 24-person bus that sits in a parking lot every Sunday, not driven. Do you want to drive it? I'll put you on the insurance right now. But when are we going to get so overcome and overwhelmed by the power of the gospel that we refuse to come to church without someone else? We refuse to come to church unless we bring the youth of Lakeland with us. Well, now we're talking. I'm getting excited. The youth, these young boys, they're setting the culture. They're giving themselves to prayer and fasting. Hallelujah, for 10 days, and then they keep going. Look at the results. Then let our appearance be observed in your presence. 14. So we listened to them in this matter and tested them for 10 days. I love this. At 15. And the end of the 10 days, their appearance seemed better. God's ways are better. His ways are not our ways. The way he chooses to do warfare is humility. In brokenness, in Christ's likeness, Jesus shifted atmospheres through meekness. Through picking up our crosses and dying to what we want. I want to leave a legacy to my children. Maybe an epitaph on my gravestone that said, he died to himself so that Jesus might live. We need some revival and some marriages in here. We need some revival and some marriages in here. What's God's will for my life? Here I tell you, just die. I mean, this is a rabbit trail, but did God not know what he was doing? I mean, he is amazing. His wisdom blows my mind. Romans 8:29, in his foreknowledge, he predestined us to be conformed to his image and likeness. God is a genius. I don't understand how you can be married and have children and not be conformed to the image and likeness of Jesus. It was a divine setup. He was coming at your flesh from the get-go. Man, or do we just have a bunch of super spiritual people in here? Or maybe we're frustrating the grace of God because we're not listening to our spouse. We're not serving them. We're not dying to our desires and saying, you pick where we go today. You pick what we do this weekend. I'm sorry. I'm wrong. I take responsibility for my sin. I'm sorry. Prayer and fasting. Verse 15, they looked better than all the guys who ate cheeseburgers. These boys, I hate vegetables. They ate green, I can't even think of any, green beans and broccoli. Oh my God. Hey, we're in the South. Is macaroni and cheese not a vegetable? These boys ate vegetables and water. The boys come in who ate steak. And it's apparent. It's visible. What does this mean? We've got to get to that place, beloved, where our Christianity, it's visible. When you walk into the room, people know that you're saved. I don't care whether it's because the way you love people. I don't care whether it's the way that you prophesy to people. Whether the anointing of God follows your life. And when you walk into a 7-Eleven, the power of God falls. We've just got to get to that place where we are persuaded that who's living on the inside of us is real.
Yeah.
Everything that you need to be a victorious Christian is living. Living on the inside of you. Should we have a roaring service? Let's just start roaring like lions. We're talking about Daniel. You know what he had? He had Daniel's den loyalty. He was loyal to God even in the face of the lions. The Lord is calling on many of you this week that are business people in this room. Will you be loyal to me even in the face of what you're going to face this week?
Yeah.
Lord, give us opportunities to get ourselves in trouble. It's kind of crazy. Lord, give me an opportunity to make somebody feel awkward. Dude, we've got so much more to cover. What time is it for real? You guys got 10 more minutes? All right, Holy Spirit, help us right now because we're going to come in. I feel like it's going to be a rough landing. You better buckle your seatbelt. You ready? Turbulence is coming. Turbulence is coming to America. Nebuchadnezzar is legislating all these things, and there's young men that God found that took a stand, that were faithful. They gave themselves to prayer and fasting. Beloved, I'm telling you, the devil loses grip on your life when you give your money away. The devil loses grip on your life when you fast and pray. It's a lifestyle. When I don't feel the fire of God, you know what that indicates to me? Nothing's on the altar. Time to put something on the altar. I don't care what it is. If you don't feel the fire of God this morning, put something on the altar. Literally, we're serving a God where you can't outgive Him. There's no sacrifice you'll ever make that won't be worth the cost. I really feel like the Lord has come to challenge some of us this morning. I am the God who will answer by fire. Do not be conformed to the ways of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. This is what it means to repent. We've got to change the way we think, which obviously leads to the way that we act. Lord, if I have had thoughts where I've been raised in church, trying to simply do church and then fit in the rest of the week, can I just encourage you, some of us have got to stop living for the weekend. You know the problem with business people that say that? Can I just be honest and, you know, just crush toes now? The problem with saying that I just can't wait for the weekend is you're going to miss God Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Yes. I can't wait till this is over. Well, why can't you invite God into what needs to be over? We just slave and just get crushed 50, 60 hours a week and just pray for a breath of fresh air on Sunday. God's got a lot more for you than that.
Amen.
All right. Put on your seatbelts. Are you ready? Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4. I just want to get this out here. I'm preaching on something totally different tonight, so I can't really do part two. I've got something else burning in me for tonight. Ephesians 4. 17. This I say therefore and affirm together with the Lord, that you walk no longer as the Gentiles also walk, and the futility, there it is, of their mind. What was their problem? Their mind. Being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of their heart. And they, having become callous, have given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of greediness. 20, here it is. But you, who's you? But you did not learn Christ this way. I'm telling you, we're living in days of America where another gospel is being preached, and it is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. You cannot be a practicing homosexual and go to heaven, just as you cannot be a practicing heterosexual and go to heaven. If the gospel is not offensive to our flesh, the gospel is not being preached. Literally, this kind of simple foundational truth should cause us to shout and rejoice. But I'm telling you, some of us, when we cringe, it's an indicator that the world's grip has a hold on us. I don't know what to coin the term, like joy-filled holiness. Like there's actually a place in God where you can live holy, righteous, consecrated. It has absolutely nothing to do with self-righteousness. It has nothing to do with looking down on people. You've just caught hold of a man whose eyes burn with fire. His head is as white as wool. His voice is like the sound of many rushing waters. And you have found the one whom your soul takes delight in.
Yes.
We're going to run as fast as we can. The Lord wants to give you permission. We didn't learn Christ this way. Look at 21. Here's the condition. Here's what we're talking about. Look at verse 21. If, can you say if?
Yeah.
If indeed you have heard Him and been taught in Him, just as the truth is in Jesus. Here, there's this scary thing right now in the church. The scary thing is it whether the leaders are preaching a polluted gospel? Is that scary? Or what's scarier is people actually believe it?
Yes.
You guys are looking at me like I'm crazy. I mean, have you read Charisma? I mean, you have transgender preachers right now in America. That like hundreds of people show up to their services every Sunday. I feel like sometimes you and I, we've got no fire, no passion because our head is stuck in the sand. And I'm like, wake up, read the news, and get fired up. Hallelujah. That in reference to your former 22, your former manner of life, you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lusts of deceit, there is again, and that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and put on the new self, there's the divine nature, which is in the likeness of God, and having been created in righteousness and holiness of the truth, therefore, laying aside falsehood, speak truth, each one of you with his neighbor, for we are members of one another.
Yes.
We'll close here. Just flip it over just to Ephesians 5, verse 3. But do not let immorality or any impurity or greed even be named among you, as is proper among saints.
Yes.
You got to catch this. But do not let immorality or any impurity or greed even be named among you, as is proper among saints. Can you say saints?
Saints.
Do you know that when Paul addressed the church, he addressed them as saints in Christ Jesus? This term saints is referring to people that don't act like sinners. This is how we've tried to draw the world. Right? We're quote-unquote saved, and we evangelize, and people say, well, I'm living in adultery, I steal, I lie. And this is how we reach them. That's okay, brother. We're all sinners. I mean, I get what you're trying to say, but if you mean that I also continually and habitually live a lifestyle of sin, I'm not a sinner. I'm a saint.
Say it. Amen.
Some of you, this is the first time you've ever heard this. What am I addressing? We're not yoked with the world. We don't act like them, talk like them, live like them. And if we do, we need to get saved. This is my new motto, is I get saved every day. I think I've given my life to the Lord 167 times right now. Lord, I am yours. I've been bought with a price. I just declare, people, I go to services and they call sinners down to the front. I run down there too. Lord, save me, deliver me, set me free. I'm being blinded by just simply living in the 21st century. You and I are literally breathing in pollution every day that we live. And when we come into the church, we better not be breathing in pollution. I want some fresh air. You know, the truth will set you free, but you're going to hate it before you accept it. We need fresh oxygen in the church. It's the presence of God. It's His holiness, His righteousness, and He's inviting us in. We've got to move beyond, oh Lord, I'm sorry, and a repetitive cycle. I want to get beyond those sins that bind me and bound me and cause shame and guilt and condemnation. I want to declare the truth of God over my life, and I choose this day like Daniel. I'm going to make a choice. Though I live in America, the American spirit, that prosperity cult, it will have no place in me.
Yes.
Got to make up our mind. This is what I felt the Lord is saying to many of us. Make up your mind. When you make up your mind, says the Lord, I'll renew your mind. Hear the word of the Lord this morning. When you make up your mind, I'll renew your mind, says the Lord. I'll partner with you. I'll walk with you. I want to change the way that you think. I want to give you conviction. I want to give you delight. When you walk into places where people are living in sin, I want to cause you to be joyous. We do not have to cower to be intimidated by the works of the devil any longer. Praise God when people don't want to cuss around you anymore. Praise God when they stop inviting you to the bar. How about you start inviting them to church?
Right.
All right, let's stand.